Hey everybody, welcome back. I'm Jason with Benson Woodworking and welcome to part 6 of the new shop series. In this video, I'll be walking you through my new dust collection system as well as the ductwork that I used for this new shop. And to be clear, this is in no way, shape, or form a review video of the dust collector. It's not a review video of the ductwork. I have not had either one of the things long enough to do a solid review, but you can expect that probably in about the next 4 to 6 months. The main purpose of this video is to kind of talk about the delivery process for the dust collector, some of the specs, and some of my experiences setting up the actual dust collector and the ductwork itself. There will also be some noise tests that will be included in this video, and we'll briefly discuss the amount of CFM that I'm getting from the new dust collector and the new ductwork. The new dust collector that I got for this shop is the Harvey Gyro Air G700 dust processor. And as you can see by the looks of it, it is unlike pretty much any other dust collector that you're used to seeing. Now, why did I pick this one, or why did I even make the change? In my previous shop, a lot of you guys probably remember that I had the Jet 3 horsepower, I believe it was the JDC3. I don't have any real negative comments to make about that dust collector. It served me pretty well for the time that I had it. There was two things that really led me to start looking at a different option in this new shop. I knew I was going from a detached structure that is away from the home and moving back into what I am currently in now, which is a 3-car garage, which is attached to the home. So the two things I was concerned most with is the footprint and the noise that the machine makes. So based on some recommendations from some friends and really just doing as much research as I could on this specific dust collector, I found that this would solve both of those issues. As I already stated, my previous unit was a 3-horsepower unit, and I have downgraded in terms of horsepower to this 2-horsepower unit. Now, while I may have downgraded in horsepower, I definitely upgraded in a lot of other specs. And after talking extensively with Harvey, turns out that this machine beat out my previous Jet in most categories. In my previous shop, yes, I had the 3-horsepower dust collection unit, but my dust collection piping was very, very poor. So at no point during the entire time I owned that Jet dust collector was I ever getting what the machine was capable of. And so the interesting thing about that is now that I've downgraded, in this case, to a 2-horsepower unit, I am getting far more suction now than I ever did before with the previous unit. I want to quickly discuss kind of the delivery and unboxing of this new unit. The unit itself was delivered by a freight company, and the freight company was actually nice enough to roll the machine into my shop, which was very nice. It just comes on a pallet and it's enclosed in a cardboard box. And once I snipped all of the ties, the cardboard fell off to the side and gave me complete access to the machine. Now, there were two things that kept the machine in place on the pallet. The first was these 4 bolts, which all you had to do is remove these 4 bolts that are located underneath the dust collection bin. And then I just had to adjust the leveling feet to take all of the pressure off of the unit. Now, what I'm about to show you in this next video clip is by no means the recommended way to remove this from the pallet. However, I was by myself, and sometimes you just have to find ways to make things work. And so basically what I did was lift up on one end of the machine to get it off the blocks that it was bolted to. I then turned the opposing side and set one corner down on the ground. And then I moved over to the other side, lifted it up just enough so I could slide the pallet out from underneath it. Again, I cannot be more clear. This was not the recommended way to do it. However, I had none of the tools in which they recommended to do it, and so I had to make it work, and I did, and it was extremely easy, and there was absolutely no damage whatsoever to the machine. Once I got it off the pallet, it was extremely easy to move and go to its final place, which is the corner of my shop. I would like to discuss two issues or challenges that I faced when deciding on whether or not this is the machine that I wanted in this shop. The first one is the dustbin capacity size. With my previous Jet, I had the ability for 50 gallons of dust, and with this machine, I believe it is 32 gallons. Obviously, that is a slight downgrade in terms of capacity. However, one of the things I hated most about changing out my dust bag is that it was so large, and it was not a simple process on the Jet. Now, with this machine, yes, I will have to change it more frequently, but it'll be a much more simple process. The second challenge that I face is the location of the inlet itself. I had zero intention on ever putting the dust collector in this corner. It was actually going to be on the opposite corner. So this obviously presented a problem of how I was going to get this pipe up to the ceiling and routed out to where I needed it to go. So while this started out as a concern for me, it actually ended up working to my benefit. And the reason it worked towards my benefit is because I was actually able to get away with a lot less duct work and making a more efficient run as opposed to where I previously planned on putting it. Now, when talking about the footprint being one of the other big reasons why I changed, is as you can see, it's still a fairly wide machine. It's not a very deep machine, and it's not a very tall machine. So by switching to this machine, it gave me all of this usable space above it. And the other benefit too is that it's low enough to where this could actually go under just about any work surface that you have in your shop. And at some point, I actually may even build some sort of flat top for over the top of it. Now I want to discuss the actual ductwork itself. I went with a company called NORDFAB, and if you're not familiar with NORDFAB, NORDFAB makes metal clamped together ductwork. So before I get into the specifics, I do want to kind of walk you through the way that my dust collection is laid out. So the inlet on the machine is a 6-inch inlet, which gave me the ability to run a 6-inch main trunk line. So from the machine coming directly out, I have my 6-inch trunk line, which leads to a 45 that takes me up the wall. Along that run, I have my first Y, which goes from a 6 to a 4-inch and leads into the bandsaw. Continuing up the wall, I get all the way to the ceiling where I have another Y, which reduces from a 6 to a split 4. The 4-inch section going left out of the Y leads out to where my table saw and joiner planer combo is going to be. One hose is dedicated to my table saw, the other hose will be dedicated to my joiner planer combo, and the blue hose is just an auxiliary hose which I can hook up to my drum sander or my router table when in use. Going straight out of the Y leads down to my CNC machine. At the end of that run, it turns in order to be centered on the CNC machine and drops down onto a swivel ball head, which allows for unimpeded movement while the head of the CNC is actually in operation. This was a great decision because it does not allow for any binding or anything with the hose, and it keeps the hose completely out of the way. I ordered all of my NORDFAB ductwork through John Benson at Air Pro of Denver. This is not a sponsored video in any way. I just want to share the information because I had such an awesome experience throughout this entire process. I do not have a gigantic amount of ductwork in my shop, and I spent just over $2,000 on that small amount of ductwork. What I got through this process was constant communication back and forth for what seemed like months, trying to develop the perfect system, and he walked me through step by step exactly what I needed to do, exactly what parts I needed, and I could not be more pleased with the end result. I will leave a link to their website and his direct email. Should you be in the market for NORDFAB, I cannot recommend enough going through AirPro Denver and talking with John. There are two primary reasons why I decided to go with NORDFAB. One is the ease of installation, and the second is actually the ease in making any kind of adjustments if needed. While I don't have any intentions on making huge adjustments to my shop, the simple fact that if I needed to make a change or I needed to unclog one of the pipes, it's as simple as me just unclamping that section, taking it out, and putting it back in. Initially, I had no plans on trying to install this myself, but with everything that's been going on lately, it was just a lot easier for me to go ahead and attempt it on my own, and it turned out to be much easier than I actually anticipated. Once I got my first section out of the machine and actually attached to the wall, from that point, it was as simple as me just clamping on the next piece. There are a few bullet points that I would like to address when it comes to the install itself. The first thing deals with the clamps. Each one of these clamps are basically spring tension clamps. So a very helpful pointer that I was given was before you try to connect two pieces together, take one of the clamps and place it on any one of the pieces that is the same size, whether it's 4-inch or 6-inch. Then depress that clamp to release all of that tension, and then the next time you go to clamp it down, it clamps down very easily. And that was a really, really good tip. And I would definitely recommend you guys do the same thing because as you're up on a ladder and you're trying to hold, you know, one pipe, it could be very difficult to, while you're holding that pipe or trying to hold something in place, clamp that thing down with all of that tension still in the clamp. Another thing that I wanted to make sure I did was to keep the pipe itself away from the wall. I did not want any section of this to actually be resting directly against the wall. So what I decided to do was use these small strips of scrap 3/4-inch black melamine. And then periodically along that run, I just found studs, bolted it into the studs, and then pushed my pipe up against that. This worked really well and gave me a little bit of room from the pipe to the wall. The method that I chose to attach the pipe directly to the wall and or the ceiling was just some of this metal pipe hanging strap. I used this in my previous shop. It worked very well, and this was not actually the original plan for this shop. I did actually purchase the NORDFAB metal hangers, but found that with the way that I was setting up my shop and doing it on my own, it was actually just far easier to use this strap hanging material. I will admit it doesn't look as sexy, but it gets the job done, and that's really the only thing that I cared about. The next bullet point is the adjustability. So there were multiple occasions where I had things assembled, and as I clipped everything together, I realized that it in fact was not where I needed that pipe to be. So as a result, it was extremely easy for me just to unclamp that one section, turn it in whatever direction I needed to turn it, and reclamp it back down, and it was done. To me, this is a huge benefit, and I'm so glad that I had the ability to do that. I didn't have to take off any tape or anything like that. And the last bullet point that I want to highlight on the install itself is actually cutting the pipe to make any different lengths that you need based on your setup. I was lucky enough to only have to cut one section, and then I was able to use the cutoff from that to complete the other area where I was going to need to cut down pipe. The way that I cut this pipe is just using my jigsaw with a metal cutting blade. It cut through the pipe with absolutely no problems at all. And the way that this works is you take the distance that you need, and then you will add 5 inches to that, and that is the length that you need to cut the pipe. So you now have one end that has no flange that will be inserted into one of these coupling pieces. Once you've inserted it into the coupling piece, based on whatever distance you need, you then take that rubber ring and slide that down onto the piece that you just inserted. Then you use your clamp to clamp to both the flange on the upper pipe and the rubber ring, and that creates your seal. So for the noise testing, what I'm gonna do is on the left-hand side, you're gonna see the decibel level that is being emitted on the lowest setting for the Harvey dust collector, which is at 40 hertz. And then the max setting is going to be on the right-hand side, and that is running at 75 hertz. The decibel meter is in the same location in the shop. It is roughly about 12 to 15 feet away from the machine, which is basically dead center of my shop. And to get a good idea of the noise that is being emitted from the machine on each one of these power settings, I'll go ahead and put those here now. Now that is much quieter than my last machine. It's much more enjoyable to be in here. And then one of my biggest concerns was neighbors. When I go outside and actually see if I can hear anything, it is a very low hum. And standing in my driveway, I can hear everything else that's going on outside over the hum that's coming out of my garage. So to close this video out, I want to talk about CFM and show you kind of some tests, right? Let me give you some backstory to my whole CFM issue. So as soon as I got the machine, I wanted to see what kind of CFM it was pulling, because as I was just holding my hand in front of the ports, I was so shocked at the suction that I was getting compared to my previous unit. So after talking to some friends of mine, I actually went online and purchased this anemometer as a recommendation from my buddy Ty. And little did I know that this thing actually maxes out at 5,906 feet per minute. Now, why is that important? Well, the numbers that I wanted to get in order to do the equation to determine my CFM was feet per minute. So while I was doing my initial tests, that's when I realized this thing kept stopping at 5,906. I just thought that that's what I was getting. Well, it turns out it's not. That's just as high as the machine goes, and that's why it kept giving me that reading. So then I went online and looked for another anemometer that would give me higher readings, and I found this one from a company called Hold Peak. This one is capable of reading 8,800 feet per minute. Well, what happened was, is when I started doing my tests with this one as soon as I got it, at 8,800 feet per minute, and it snapped the fin right off and went into the machine. And just to give you an idea, so the machine that maxes out at 5,906, that's about the equivalent to 515 CFM on my machine with the ductwork and the equation, and we're not going to get into that in this video, but it's 515 CFM. Now, 8,800 feet per minute comes out to about 768 CFM. What I can tell you is that each one of my ports maxed out the new machine prior to it breaking, which means at every single one of my tools, I'm getting at least 750 CFM. That is based off all of my initial tests. I will throw in some different tests that I did here with the anemometer that I do have. This is going to be on my CNC at three different power settings. So this first one is the 40 hertz power setting. This next one is right in between the minimum and the max at 62.5 hertz. As you can see, it is maxing out this anemometer, which means I'm getting at least 515 CFM at this tool, which is my longest run with the machine at half power. Now I've got it turned all the way up to 75 hertz and it is maxing out the machine almost instantaneously. I hope that all the information in this video gives you a better idea of the machine that I'm using, the ductwork that I'm using, why I decided to go to this. And I just want everybody to know that so far, I am so pleased with the performance of not only the dust collector, but also the ductwork. From my experience now, having that really good, efficient ductwork makes a world of difference. I think that the ductwork is just as important as the machine itself, if not more important. That is gonna do it for me in this video. Make sure you keep an eye out for part seven. In part seven, I'm actually just gonna go ahead and wrap in the miter saw station and assembly table and do a really good overview, mainly because they're constructed pretty much the same way. If you guys have any questions, you're unclear about anything, if you want any more information on any of the products that I went with, you can either look down in the description below or feel free to send me an email or send me a DM over on Instagram at @BensWoodworking and I'd be happy to answer any questions that you might have. Thank you so much everybody for your continued support, and until next time, get out in the shop, try something new, and I will see you in part seven. Thanks.